Hey, what's up everyone? Welcome to another video. This is just a continuation of the last statement of purpose video that I made, and in this video I'm going to be telling you about a few things that you can be mindful of, or a few things that you should avoid when you're drafting your statement of purpose. The first thing is plagiarism. Do not by any means copy from any kind of resource, be it your seniors, be it your batchmates, be it the internet, whatever the case may be. You know, it can happen sometimes where you think, okay, you know, I have a senior who's gotten an admit from a university and he or she has already studied there, so you might feel like, you know, they got an admit because of their SOP and you want to read their SOP, and once you read it you might feel like yours is not capable enough to get an admit, because, you know, we as humans kind of tend to underestimate ourselves a little bit, and you might think, okay, you know, I like this line, it's phrased better than what I've written, I'll just take that from theirs. And it might happen to another line, it might happen to a third sentence, and you don't want to increase that level of plagiarism, because first of all, you got to keep in mind these applications are holistic, your GPA, your GRE if you're submitting it, projects, research work, internship experience, work experience, all of these things matter, all of these things go into your application, and it's not just your statement of purpose. Secondly, your SOP is your direct pitch to the university. It's like, you know, you telling them your motivation behind applying to a program, and that could be different from somebody else's, you know, motive to apply. So how is that going to sink in with what your expectations are if you're going to take somebody else's document and, you know, just make changes according to you and send it in? You can get it proofread, of course, by all means. You can get it proofread by your seniors or maybe your batchmates who've gone a year earlier, one term before you or something like that. That's always fine. You can also refer a lot of internet resources just to get a hang of how to draft it, but do not by any means copy. It's just going to hinder your chances of getting an admit, and like, these applications are pretty expensive, so why would you want to falter there? Like, just put your heart and soul into it. Yeah, so if you want to check your plagiarism percentage, there is one online tool which I found very handy called SST Tools. It's smartco2s.com or something. Either I'm not very sure of the name, I don't remember it, but I've used it and it's very, very helpful. So I will leave a link in the description. All the links will be down in the description below. The second thing you should not do is go to a consultant for your statement of purpose. I can't stress enough on this. I've made a separate video where I've bashed consultancies. Just go check that out. I mean, it's got enough context in itself. I don't want to repeat the same things here, but do not by any means go to a consultant. It's just a waste of money. The third thing is grammar. Now, bad grammar could be an instant turn off. I mean, spelling mistakes are definitely going to be a turn off. So you'd want to get your grammar checked before you submit your final draft of your statement of purpose. And one online tool that I found is Grammarly. It's pretty handy. You know, it gives you a word count, so it can help you, you know, tailor your statement to get into the word limit as well. And it also helps you make corrections, you know, as in wherever it's necessary, wherever required. It could help you shorten sentences as well. It'll help you remove redundancy. So Grammarly is always a helpful tool. That's what I used as well. So yeah, Grammarly is like your go-to tool if you want to get your grammar checked and stuff. The fourth thing is, you know, try to avoid exceeding the word limit as much as possible. Obviously, one thing is, you know, they're giving you a word limit for a reason. Now, even if you do exceed it, something like 5-10 words is not gonna make that much of a difference. But let's assume you exceed your statement of purpose by 50 words or 100 words simply because you think, okay, you've mentioned something very important that has taken up that extra space. Let's say 500 people apply and all 500, of course it's hypothetical, but let's assume all 500 have the same approach and each of them has exceeded the word limit by like 50 to 100 words. Let's just keep 50 words as the benchmark. What is 50 into 500? 25,000 words. Let's assume you're able to fit 1,000 words into one page. That would mean how many? 25 pages extra for the application reviewing people to read. Why would they want to read 25 extra pages? Just think about it. It's extra work for them, and if you've unnecessarily, you know, extended your word limit, then it could just hinder your chances again. They've given you a word limit for a reason, so as much as you possibly can, try to stay within the word limit. Exceeding it by like 2 or 3 words, not that big of a deal, but if it's 50 words, 100 words or something, then yeah, it's better to shorten it a little bit. And how do you shorten it? By reiterating. It's not going to happen overnight. You know, it's not going to happen over 2 or 3 days. It could take you some time, but yeah, put in that time because these applications, they come at a pretty big price. The next thing I want to tell you is, to avoid generic statements, very general statements, you know, listing out all your subjects that you've taken in your undergrad or, putting statements like the industry is revolving, the industry is changing, the world is very fast paced and technology is evolving, which is why I feel like I need to improve my skills. I need to, enhance my knowledge in this particular field, which is why I'm applying for postgrad, because that is very generic. That is why all of us are doing it. Like, what else is your motivation? You know what I'm saying? It's very, very generic. So putting up these kind of generic statements is just going to, consume words. And let's assume someone who's reading applications reads 10 applications and all 10 people have written something as general as, I need to improve my skills. I feel like I lack skills that I can work on, which is why I'm applying to postgrad. It's just going to make your thing redundant. It's more important to be very, very specific. Like, why are you applying? What is your motivation? You get what I'm saying? It could be different from each individual. Maybe cite an instance, maybe cite a challenge that you might have faced while working on some project or some internship or some extracurricular activity that probably influenced your decision to maybe switch majors. Explain an instance which is motivating you to apply rather than just putting up very generic statements like I've already mentioned. The next thing I want to say is do not elaborate your resume, because that is pretty general as well. And just think about it, like your entire body of work, everything that you've done, preferably in your undergrad and after, is going to be on your resume. Why would you elaborate that in one line of saying things like, I did this internship in this summer, which taught me this, and this led to another internship the following summer. This led to me taking up this research project and so on. So it's very generic. Instead of putting one-liners, mentioning everything in your resume on your statement of purpose, describe a story, tell a story. Like, for example, with me, what I did in one instance was I said I did not like electrical engineering in my undergrad, which is why I wanted to figure out what I wanted to pursue in life in the long run. And I took up a lot of extracurriculars, just to see what I naturally gravitated towards. And one thing led to another, and slowly I started learning more and more and more about myself, which led me to pursuing dash. I will mention what that dash is in a different video, but I hope you get the gist of what I'm trying to say. Or another thing, when I got a scholarship, I did not mention anything. This is in my undergrad, not postgrad. I could have just mentioned what I wrote in my resume saying I got a scholarship in my second semester, blah, blah, blah. But I didn't do that. Instead, I built a story around it saying in my first semester, my grades dipped. And that motivated me to, study a little harder in my second semester, which got me a scholarship. And thereon, because I knew how hard I'd have to work and maintain that grade up to a certain level, I also saw a slump in my grades in the fifth semester. And I came back even stronger the next semester, and I was able to bump my grades up again. So this way, it's like constantly saying these are the kind of, of course, I elaborated in a much more detailed manner. I didn't just put words together like I did right now. But, it's like telling a story about myself. Basically, what I'm trying to say is, instead of directly just stating that I got a scholarship and, just putting it off as, me praising myself, I tried to build a story around the fact that every time I saw a slump in my grades, I worked harder to bring it back up, which is like saying, hey, I dealt with this challenge and this is how I overcame it, and that's why I have the academic competence required. I hope I'm able to make my point clear when I say this. I'm not just trying to bloat myself up here. So basically, instead of just listing stuff out on your resume, in your statement of purpose, try to weave a story around your motivation. It's unique from every single person. So try to weave a story around it again. The last thing I want to mention is try to very, very explicitly explain what your future plan is immediately after you graduate. It's something that we kind of tend to miss out on because you're trying to convince them that, hey, I'm the right person for this program. You're trying to build a story around yourself. You might forget to include the part of the story where, once this ends, like, what is my motive behind applying to this program? That's what the document is all about. It's called statement of purpose for a reason. What is your purpose? Why do you want it? Why do you want to go pursue this particular degree in such a far-off university? Like, what is your objective? What do you want to do immediately? Do you want to work? Do you want to pursue research? Do you want to, whatever it is, whatever your end goal is, short-term goal after graduating and how that's going to fall in line with your long-term goal. Even if you don't mention your long-term goal, it should be fine as long as you're able to justify why you want to go so far and what you want to do immediately after you graduate. It's pretty important to put this point in because obviously, you know, they want to know what your motivation is behind applying to this program, what your future plan is. Like, you're not going to be applying without anything and without any future plan in mind, right? That's the basic gist of it. So that's all I had to say for this video. I hope you found this helpful. All the links will be down in the description below. So yeah, everything, your go-to guide is in the description. And I just want to put this out there. I've been getting a few messages and I've also seen comments where people are like, this is my score, this is my entire profile, suggest universities for masters in computer science in USA, or suggest universities to me, suggest some good universities that I can apply to. First of all, I've made a separate video on how you can pick universities to apply to, so please check that out. You'll understand from the video where I'm mentioning it's a very individualistic process. You might want to apply to a college which somebody else might not want to apply to. That shouldn't stop you from applying. So it's a very individualistic process which is going to take you a lot of research. It's not something that a third person can tell you. And like, I am in no position to tell someone else where they should apply and where they shouldn't apply and why they should apply where I'm telling them to apply. It doesn't work that way. Like, it's very individualistic. You see a program you like, you see a university you like, whatever reason it could be, you know. Maybe you want to go to a remote town because it's cheaper to live there. Maybe you want to go to a big city because you're a very happening person. It's individualistic to every single person. So, like, I'm in no position to tell you where to apply and where not to apply. I'm sorry if that sounded rude, but like, I'm not a counselor or anything. I'm just documenting. I'm a student just like you. I'm documenting everything that I'm undergoing with this application process so that it can help someone else out. That's it. This is not me sitting in one place and just giving information out there. And like, to those of you who are asking about me, where I'm applying, what I'm applying for and all, I'll reveal all that when the time is right. Okay. Okay, so that's it for this video. Thank you so much for watching. I hope this was helpful. I hope this content is helpful in one way or another. Please give me a like. Please subscribe to my channel to support my content. And yeah, that's all I have to say. Thank you so much for watching, guys. I'll see you in the next one. Bye-bye.